So in yesterday's class, we saw that the propagation delay, like the RC delay through an inverter, driving another inverter, for finding this out, the equivalent circuit that we need to consider is essentially something like this. As the output over here, we have a total capacitance of 3 times C. This is the drain diffusion capacitance. Okay. And at the input of the next inverter, the input gate capacitance of that inverter also has this value 3C. And this is the gate capacitance of the two transistors that form the input of the second inverter. Right? So what we usually do is to explicitly make a difference and to call this the second stage gate capacitance as the external load. Whereas the drain diffusion capacitance, if you think about it, what has happened over here is, why is the drain diffusion capacitance over there? Because of the driver itself. The driver transistor, the driver gate transistor themselves have some drain diffusion. There is nothing you can do about it. You don't want it to be there because it's not really part of the external load that you want to drive. But just because of the fact that there is a drain area and because of the way it is constructed, it has a capacitance. That capacitance also has to be taken into account when you are calculating the delay. Because of that, this capacitance, the drain diffusion, is usually referred to as a parasitic. Okay? It's like a parasite. It serves no useful purpose. But it is there and it has to be taken into account when you are calculating the delay through the gate. Okay? So if you look at the overall delay, there is a contribution due to the external load and there is another contribution due to the parasitic. Okay. In general, there should be some factor gamma, because it's not always necessary that the parasitic capacitance is exactly equal to the gate capacitance. We know that it's going to be proportional because both of them are proportional to the width of the transistor. But the fact that they are equal is a coincidence. In general, we have to consider some factor gamma as the ratio between them. Okay? But that's it. It just becomes some one constant ratio, which again is dependent on the technology. Okay. So, like I said, for the rest of this course at least, we will be simplifying matters and assuming gamma is equal to 1. And therefore, the parasitic capacitance and the gate capacitance are equal in magnitude. Okay? Okay, what happens if instead of another inverter, we were driving some arbitrary capacitance? What would be the delay through this? Huh? R into CL, right? Is that all there is to it? Plus the parasitic. Okay? So the total delay would then be R into CL, this would be external, plus how much will the parasitic be? Same as before. Right? It depends only on the size of the transistor. Okay? Another way of writing this is okay. I have taken out the 3RC term as a constant, right? And now I can write the total delay as CL by 3C plus 1. Okay? Why am I doing it this way? Because this allows me to visualize the load, that load capacitance CL, in a slightly different term. Instead of in units of capacitance, instead of femtofarad, effectively what it's telling me is how many inverters is this load equivalent to? Right? CL divided by 3C. 3C is the capacitance of one minimum size inverter. So CL divided by 3C is, this is the number of minimum size inverters that this load is equivalent to. Okay? So instead of saying it's 5 femtofarads or 10 femtofarads, if I can say that it's equivalent to 4 inverters or 8 inverters, that's a more useful expression, simply because it also becomes independent of a number of other features such as the size of the inverter. Okay, we'll see that in a moment. Okay. Now, so all of this was assuming that the inverter was of so-called minimum size, right? Where the Wn, the width of the nMOS, is 4 lambda. Wp, the width of the pMOS, is 8 lambda. Okay? So minimum size or unit inverter, or sometimes we refer to it as the reference inverter, has Wn equal to 4 lambda, Wp equal to 8 lambda, Ln equal to Lp equal to 2 lambda. Okay? So this is sort of the definition of the minimum size inverter, the unit inverter. Okay? Inverter of size A therefore by extension we will just say Wn equals 4k lambda, Wp equals 8k lambda, but Ln equal to Lp remains the same as 2 lambda, not 2k lambda. Okay? So this is arbitrary, I am defining something called an inverter of size k. Okay? Alright, now if I have an inverter of size k, what do these capacitances and the resistances look like? So how much is the total input capacitance that I am going to see? For k equal to 1, I have seen 3C. Right? C from the NMOS, 2C from the VMOS. For some other value of k, what do I see? K times C. 3 into k into C. Okay? What about the NMOS diffusion capacitance? It will be k times c. CMOS diffusion capacitance? 2k times. Okay? NMOS resistance? R by k. Right? A wider transistor will deliver more current for a given VGS, VDS, etc. So, equivalently, its resistance can be thought of as going down by the same factor. And what about the PMOS resistance? Also R by K. Remember it is 8K lambda. Okay, that ratio of Wp by Wn equal to 2 has still been maintained. Alright, now with this, I drive some load. Okay, what is the device going to do? R by K into CL, right? Because either it's charging, that is the P MOS is active, or discharging, the N MOS is active. Okay? In either case, the equivalent resistance is R by K. So the external delay is always R by K times CL. Alright? Plus R by K into 3K RC. Sorry, 3K C. Okay? Note this point. The resistance went down by a factor of K. The capacitance went up. So now let me rewrite this in the same form that I have done earlier. I take out the factor 3RC. 3RC itself. Okay? So do you see what has happened over here? I have two components, external delay, parasitic delay. The parasitic delay has remained unchanged. Okay? So I took this inverter, I made it bigger. Why do I make the inverter bigger? So that it can deliver more current and can charge up the load faster. Okay, it can deliver more current. Unfortunately, what happens as a side effect is, because the inverter is bigger, the transistors are bigger, their parasitic capacitance is also bigger. Okay? Net effect is that the contribution of the parasitic delay remains the same. What about the external delay? That is now PL divided by 3KC, that is the size of this new inverter. So how big is the load compared to my new inverter, not to the unit inverter? Right? So let's say I take an inverter of size 2. I have two inverters. This is of size 1. Try to drive some load here. I also have another inverter of size 2. Try to drive the same load here. Right? Delay through this is going to be given by 3RC into CL by 3C plus 1. Delay through this is going to be given by 3RC into CL by 6C plus 1. Okay? So the bigger driver brings down the external delay. Because of this, CL by 60 instead of CL by 3. But the parasitic delay remains the same. Remains unchanged. That's plus 1. Okay? So this is something to keep in mind. If you want to sort of reduce the delay through some gate, the most obvious and first thing that comes to mind is make the gate bigger so that it can deliver more current. And yes, that is correct. That is in fact the best way of reducing the delay through the gate. But the thing that you need to keep in mind over there is, there's a problem. You cannot do this arbitrarily long. Okay? If you arbitrarily increase the size of that gate, then the parasitic is going to take over and that will become your flow. You cannot decrease the delay beyond that. Okay? So this is something important to keep in mind, this distinction between external delay and parasitic delay. We'll be focusing on this quite a bit more over the next few classes when we take over on the topic of logical effort and choosing the sizes of transistors for arbitrary case. Okay. Today I am going to go into another topic, not another topic but a continuation of this, which is to say, let's say that I have a given load that I want to drive. Okay? I know that I have some capacitance, let's say 1 picofarad or something like that, and I want to be able to drive a digital signal onto it. What do I mean by drive a digital signal? I need to be able to make the capacitance go up to VDD or go down to 0 as required, as logic level. Okay? I have some Boolean logic that is happening inside my circuit and some computation, and the output of some gate I have this signal. I want it to be able to drive this capacitance, and let's assume this capacitance is large. Okay? I want to find out the best way of driving that capacitance. Okay? So I'm going to take up an example. So there is some Boolean signal here and a load capacitance here. Okay? For clarity, I'm going to assume first that this Boolean signal is being driven by an inverter. Okay, a unit inverter. Okay? So when I have a unit inverter, I know what the capacitance is on this side. And I also know that this load capacitance is large compared to 3C of the unit inverter. Okay? My first question is, how much is the delay through this? So right now, what's the delay through this? 3RC into CL by 3C plus 1. Okay? Let's consider an example. CL equal to 1000 times per phase. I don't care what the actual numbers are. Right? That's the beauty of what's happening over there. Right? And also, I will assume that 3RC, this number over here, is equal to, let's say, 15 picoseconds, which is pretty much the number that you will find for the 180 nanometer technology. Okay? So what is the delay now? 15 picoseconds into 1000 plus 1. Say nanoseconds is the delay through this inverter. Okay? Remember what we were talking about. The normal delays are in the range of 3RC or 6RC. Right? So around 30 picoseconds or thereabouts. We suddenly have one delay of one gate alone, which is 1000 times that. Why is it 1000 times? Because the load it has to drive is 1000 times the normal load that it sees. Okay, so it will deliver current, it will take a long time to sort of charge the entire thing up and take 1000 times as long as it would have taken if it was just a simple inverter at the load. Okay, so 15 nanoseconds, quite a long time compared to the 30 picoseconds that we would normally expect. Okay, so the question is, can we do better? I want to reduce this delay. Okay? Now this is a common scenario. Right? A factor of 1000 may not be so common, but definitely inside logic circuits you would find that, you know, up to a factor of 10 or 100 or something like that is entirely possible. 1000 is also possible when you are trying to drive outputs of the chip. Okay? Because inside the chip all your capacitances are in the femtofarad grade. The moment you try taking out onto one of the pins and going across the PCB to another chip, the capacitance of that entire line is easily in the picofarad grade. Okay? So this example that I am giving you, 1000 times of the inverter capacitance, is not an unrealistic example. Okay, it is definitely something which can come up in practice. Okay? So now, I am going to give you one extra level of freedom and tell you, look, I don't care whether X or X bar comes out onto the output. Okay? So you are free to add as many inverters as you want. You can even put 2 inverters or 3 inverters. I don't care. Right? As long as the data or the complement of the data comes over there, I can work with it. Okay? In other words, you have the freedom of choosing. Inverters as you want. Which is the best? And how should I choose them? Okay? Now the first question of course that you might ask is, why should I add more than one inverter? Am I going to get any benefit at all from adding more than one inverter? Why do we get a benefit from adding more than one inverter? Let's take an example. Let's say that this is 1, or okay, this. The second inverter, let's say, is 10 times as big as the first inverter. And then I drive the load. This is 1000 inverters. Now, what is the total delay through this circuit? If I have 2 elements, one after the other, right? How is the delay defined? It's basically saying, okay, now the first input has gone from 0 to 1 or from 1 to 0. Correspondingly, the first output goes from 1 to 0 or 0 to 1, right? The opposite transition. And that in turn causes a change on the next stage. So the total delays are going to add. Okay? What is B1? 3RC into 10, right? The ratio of the first stage load to the first stage capacitance plus 1, the parasitic of the first stage itself. Okay? What is B2? 3RC into 1000 divided by 10, not 1. Okay, remember it was divided by 3kc, the capacitance of the k times inverter. But the parasitic remains the same, plus 1. Okay, how much is this? So this is 15 picoseconds. Into 11 plus 101. Okay? So, approximately 100 times, right? It's a little more than 1500 picoseconds, maybe 1600 also, that's okay. I don't care about the exact number. What is important is, from 15,000 it came down to 1500. Huh? Okay, so what has happened over here? Let's just go back and take a look at this. According to this calculation, the delay is going to be this 3RC multiplied by Cn by 3KC. Right, K times 3T. That is to say, the capacitance of this K-sized inverter. Okay? Plus 1, the parasitic. That part remains the same. Okay? So that's what I have done over here as well. What I have done is, for the second stage, what is the load on the second stage? 1000. What is its own strength? 10 times. It is 10 times bigger than a unit size inverter. So 1000 divided by 10 plus 1. Okay? For the first stage, of course, what is its load? The load that it sees is only the second inverter, not the last stage. So the first inverter sees only the second inverter. It does not see the big capacitor. That's the crucial difference over here. Right, I have isolated it into separate stages. The first inverter sees only the second inverter. So as far as the first inverter is concerned, the load that it has to drive is 10 times the unit inverter. Okay? So its delay comes out to this 10 plus 1. For the second inverter, it is seeing 1000 times of a unit inverter, but itself it is 10 times of a unit inverter. So 1000 divided by 10. Its parasitic remains the same, plus 1. Because even though it has become 10 times bigger, its parasitic capacitance also has become 10 times bigger. Is this part clear to everyone? Okay? Because please make sure that you go over this and understand it again. This is a somewhat crucial part as far as the rest of the discussion, what you are going to have over the next 1 week about so called logical effort. Understanding this is crucial to that. Okay, so please make sure that you go over it, and if you have any doubts, get it clear. Okay? So, what you are seeing right now is, by just adding, yeah, go ahead. The first time we just had a unit inverter. Okay, so that one is fixed. I can't change its size. Because if I change its size, it will change the delay of whatever is driving up to that. So that's a good point. So the question was essentially, this is the problem statement I said, and I said this size, this was a size 1. So the question is, why not just make this size 2? Right? So as somebody pointed out, something else is driving this. Okay. So if you change the capacitance here, this delay will change. Okay? So you have to take something as your starting point and say that that capacitance is fixed. So my first gate, I cannot change the capacitance. Because that is being driven by someone else who I don't have any control over. Okay. When you are typically designing a large circuit, let's say a microprocessor, you will be designing the ALU. So that will be some part of it, which is let's say the adder unit. Adder unit, where is it getting its input from the register. Okay. So somebody else will be designing the register file. So the register file designer will say, okay, I am going to design my register so that they can drive a load of so many microfarads. The person who is designing the adder says, okay, I am going to design my adder assuming that whoever is driving me has this much drive capability. From there I will design up to this. The output of the adder has to be able to drive this capacitance. So you make sure that you give me this capacitance too. Okay? So the first stage and the last stage typically have to be fixed. And that is fixed by somebody else who is fixing at the system level. So that is the reason why we could not change the first gate itself. We had to add a new gate in the mix. Okay. let's take that example further and say, I put two of them, or I put two additional inverters. Now what is the delay through this? The total delay is D1 plus D0 plus D3. This is 3RC into 10 by 1 plus 1 plus 100 by 10 plus 1 plus 1000 by 100 plus 1. Okay. Or in other words, 3RC into 33. From 1000 it has come down all the way to 33. Okay. 33 times 15 picoseconds is how much? It's around 500. Okay. Is that right? Huh? 15 times 33 is, yeah, somewhere around 500. So from 15 nanoseconds, we have brought it down to 500 picoseconds. Okay? So now the question that comes up naturally over here is, what is the best? Is this the best that we can do? Can we improve it still further? What is the limit to which we can reduce that total delay through the system? Is there a limit? Or can I keep on adding more and more stages and make the delay arbitrarily small? Okay? So what do you think? Is this the best that can be done? How would you change it? What are the other choices that you could have made? What are the things that you could have changed over there? Huh? The inverter side. I chose 10 arbitrarily. What would you have chosen? Yes. Or think about how you would solve it. Okay, so two questions there. First is, why equally? So you can prove that, right? So you should be able to prove that. The suggestion is, distribute that load, that factor of 1000, equally. It's still a trickiest question. What do you mean by equally? Do you take 1000 and make it up into 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, or do you make it some kind of, you know, first time is 10, next time is 100, next time is 1000? Right. So it is not an arithmetic division that we are doing over there. Right. It's not taking a 1000 and sort of parceling it out among so many inverters. We have to take a geometric progression. Each time it is going up by a certain size. Look at what happened here. First time I went up by a factor of 10. Then again I went up by a factor of 10. Then third time I went up by a factor of 10 and reached 1000. Okay. We can take this further. Let's in fact take the case when, this is a bit tricky to sort of take further, but anyway. The next question, so one part of it is, intuitively it looks as though distributing that load equally, right, among n inverters, makes sense. Next question is, how do you decide what is equal? Is the factor of 10 the optimal factor? or a factor of 5 or a factor of 2 or a factor of 20. What should be the successive load that I increase by at each stage? Right, you get what I'm asking. Here, I went in 3 stages. I have my first inverter. In the first stage, it increased in size by a factor of 10. That is to say, it drove an inverter which is 10 times as large as itself. Next time again by a factor of 10, third time again by a factor of 10, and I reached my goal. Question is, why 10? Nth root of last inverter by first inverter. Okay, so in other words, what we are coming to is CL divided by C0. This we can refer to as so called the total electrical load. Okay, I call this S. Right? So capital S over here is my total electrical load. It is 1000 times of the first stage inverter. If I have n stages and I want to sort of go in a way where I am growing by the optimal amount each time, then nth root of CL by C0 should be how much I grow by each stage. And that is what has happened over here. I found that growing 1, 10, 100, 1000, I got to 500 picosecond. Now, it's not clear whether that is optimal or not, but at least for this case, it seems like, you know, at least all the three stages over here are 11, 11, 11. Right? Question is, what should n be and how do I choose n? How many stages? Okay? So this is not all that hard to do. Essentially what you do is write out the delay. Okay? If we have n stages and I am not even going to make the assumption of them being equal, I will derive it. I'll call the first stage capacitance as C1. Okay, what do I mean by C1? It is the input gate capacitance of the first, that is to say, the first load stage. Okay, so it is the 3 kV of the first load. It is some value C1. I am not saying it is 10 or 20 or 4 or anything of that sort. I am just saying C1. Similarly, this is C2 and so on. Finally, I have one nth capacitance. Which in turn is driving CL. Okay? Or let me simplify this. I'll make this the n minus 1 capacitance. And I'll call CL itself as CL. That is the nth capacitance. Okay? Because I am starting from stage 0 and going up to stage n-1, there are total of n inverters in my case. And they are all finally driving this capacitance, CL, which is the nth capacitance in my case. What is the delay to this? What is the total delay through this chain? 3RC into what is the delay for the first one? C1 plus 1. For the second stage, K2 by K1 plus 1. And so on. Until the last stage is Cn by Cn minus 1 plus 1. Okay. This is the total delay through n stages. Right? Now if I want to maximize this, there are a couple of ways of doing it. One of them is just sort of using the intuition, saying that I want to maximize. Okay, so there is one part of this, so 1 plus 1 plus 1 etc. is constant. Okay, that is equal to n itself, the number of k. Okay? There is another part which is a C1. So I can rewrite this like this. This part over here is essentially something like x1, x2, x3 up to xn. Minimize sigma xn xi subject to the product of all the xi is a constant. Right? After all, what is the product of all of these things? Cn. Cn by 1. Okay? So, we want to minimize the summation of a set of numbers subject to the constraint that the product of those numbers is a constant. Okay? So, it's sort of well known actually, but the best way to do that is to explicitly say all the numbers should be equal. You can also prove it over here. What you do is you take partial derivative with respect to ci, some arbitrary ci in between. Okay? So what happens if I take the partial derivative with respect to ci? So there will be some term. The only term that depends on ci over here, there will be one term which is ci by ci minus 1, and there will be another term which is ci plus 1 by ci. When I take the derivative, ci by ci minus 1 will give this. Ci plus 1 by ci will give me this. Make this equal to 0. What does that imply? Ci squared must be equal to ci minus 1 into ci plus 1. Okay? So in other words, this entire thing must be a geometric progression. The series of xi that I have. Okay. So in this particular case, it's relatively straightforward to show that what the values should be. You make them all equal, the ratio is equal, right? Or another way of writing this is ci by ci minus 1 must be equal to ci plus 1 by ci. Okay. Which means that all the terms must be equal to each other. Okay. So once you have that, effectively what we are saying is all the terms I'm going to call it equivalent to some small s. Okay? And so what is s power n? Cn. Right? That is the total load, capital S. right? In terms of that, what is the delay to this? 3RT into N plus? What is each of these terms equal to? The C1 by 1, C2 by C1, C3 by C2, etc. are equal to small s. So the total delay is 3RC into N into 1 plus S. Okay? The problem is this still hasn't solved our final requirement. All that has done is now rewritten the entire expression that we had in terms of these two new parameters, small n and small s, both of which we don't know. We know that they are related because at least s power n is equal to capital S, which is a known factor. Right? Capital S is known. So effectively we actually have only one unknown over here, either n or small n. Right? So this is the expression that we have, the delay, and we need to minimize this with respect to n. Okay? How do you minimize this expression? How do you minimize any expression? D by dn. Okay? So I'm going to stop here for now. In the next class we'll just finish up this derivation, where what we are saying is we'll just take the derivative with respect to n, set it equal to 0. Find out what should be the optimal value of n. Okay? Intuitively what is happening? Ideally I should be able to add more and more stages and bring down that smaller value and bring the delay down as much as I can. But at some point the parasitic delays are so large that adding more stages only makes things worse. So the delays are slowly increasing again. So the delay decreases, then it slowly starts increasing again. At some point I have an optimal. This expression tells me how to find that. Okay? So this is the whole problem of how do I choose inverter sizes for a chain of inverters for driving a large load. We'll take this through and complete the example also in the next class and then move on to more complex issues in terms of sizing bigger cases.
Maybe they just wanted it wrong.